loving and delivering God. You're always willing to come to our help. It is always your intention to save and deliver us. We pray, O God, that we will never hold fast to that love that you have for us. To remember always that you are faithful and that you really want to save, to heal, to deliver us. Raise us now, we pray, from the death of sin. And help us to work towards attaining everlasting life. So that on that day when you come to judge the living and the dead, we will become worthy and ready to enter your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray.
Amen.
Let us stand as we process.
The searching.
Today is the fifth Sunday of Lent, and our service continues on page 101 of the Book of Common Prayer. Be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Blessed Lord and Father, we have assembled in your name, and in fellowship with one another. Enable us by your grace to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, to proclaim and respond to your holy word. Teach us to pray for your word and your church. Grant that we, confessing our sins, be worthy of offering to you our souls and bodies as a living sacrifice, and eat and drink of your spiritual food in this holy sacrament. Amen. Almighty God,
you are our hearts are open, all our desires known,
and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse us of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthy might by your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Reading from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 37, 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. They were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, Martha, can these bones lie? I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus say the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded. As I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh came upon them, and the sin had covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus say the Lord God, come forth and say to the breath. So thus say the Lord God, come from four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came unto them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus say the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves. O my people, I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you on your own soil, then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Amen.
Reading from the Word of God, written in the letter of Paul to the Romans, chapter 8, beginning at verse 6. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies, also through his Spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Again, for the brother, who said number 75? Who said 75?
Thank you.
Jesus Christ according to John. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard this, he said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of Man of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, and after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right. Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, the teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus was not yet come to the village, but still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews, who were with her in the house, consoling her, so Mary got up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbound him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ, Lord.
There are at least three different times
when people will gather with the family in mourning. We have a gathering for the great digging. We have a gathering for the setup. And we also have a gathering for the funeral service. In Jesus' day, people had also gathered to mourn with the family, even though the burial usually takes place 8 hours after death. In our gospel reading for today, St. John 11, 1 through to 45, Jesus' friend, Martha and Mary's brother, Lazarus, was dead. When he was ill, the sisters had sent to tell Jesus that he was ill. But Jesus did not rush to Bethany to save his friend from dying. Instead, he stayed where he was for 2 more days. Jesus stated, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of Man may be glorified through it." Jesus' disciples were not happy that he was going back to Judea. And so they said, "But Lord, you were in Judea and they almost told you there, and now you want to go back there?" As believers, we need to be aware that we may have to face uncomfortable situations, even difficult ones, but we must always remember God will always provide a way out for us. All we need to do is go in faith. And so Jesus told his disciples that their friend Lazarus was asleep and he was going to wake him. The disciples, you know, they actually thought that Lazarus was asleep. So why should you go and wake him? And then Jesus told them plainly that Lazarus is dead. Jesus knew that his disciples still had some lingering doubts about who he really is. And in an effort to assay their doubts, Jesus said to them, "For your sake, I am glad I was not there so that you may believe." When Jesus and his disciples, when they arrived in Judea, Lazarus was already dead 4 days. Now who would want to face a corpse that has been in a sealed tomb for 4 days? Jesus was cognizant that his own death was near, and he needed his disciples to believe in him. Now when we have a death, persons who come from varying distances are still phone calls to mourn with us. And we see also that persons came from as far as 2 miles from Bethany to mourn with the sisters. That says something about who the sisters were and also the kind of person that Lazarus was. And for the mourners, many of the mourners, this was the end of Lazarus. However, Martha and Mary did not share their view. And this we should note from the sisters' reaction when they heard that Jesus was coming. They went out at different times and they expressed the same sentiment when they each saw Jesus. Each of them, when they saw Jesus, said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Martha had confidence in God's ability to make the seemingly impossible possible. Said to Jesus, "But even now, I know God will give you whatever you ask of him. If only you and I had that much confidence in God." Jesus said to Martha, "Your brother will rise again." But Martha thought Jesus was referring to the idea of resurrection. But Jesus realized that she did not grasp the oneness between him and God, said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Do we believe this?" Jesus was assuring Martha that he had the power to restore Lazarus' life now, and also to offer him the hope of eternal life in glory everlasting. And so those of us today who believe in Jesus Christ need not fear death, because the same offer that Jesus extended to Lazarus also extended to us as well. Like Martha, we should be able to say with confidence, "Lord, I believe." Many of us have different ways of dealing with death of our loved ones. Many of us will cry. Many of us visit the grave. Many of us refuse to eat for weeks. And so there are many of us who refuse to take their clothing and set them aside. And there are others of us who are zombified for days. And so we can understand Mary's reaction. She shed many tears for her brother. And it was no wonder when she heard that Jesus was coming. She ran out of the house. And the mourners, who thought maybe she was going to the tomb to weep, they followed her. It was to Jesus she ran, looked at him, and fell at his feet. Jesus was moved with compassion when he saw Mary and the mourners crying. Jesus also cried. Many of us, we also cry when our friends die.
of loss can be so overwhelming, but the consolation and comfort that we have is in knowing that because of Jesus, death and the grave is not the end for believers. And if you weren't at your friend's funeral, when you finally had a chance to come, the first thing most of us want to see is where he was buried, he or she is buried. And Jesus was no different. So when he came after 4 days with Lazarus in the tomb, Jesus wanted to go to the tomb where Lazarus was. And so Lazarus, Martha, Mary, and the Jewish mourners, they all went to Lazarus' tomb. And Jesus asked them to take away the stone. Martha said to him, "After all, they ain't getting no sleep by now. Furthermore, after 4 days, the body would have started to decompose, and the worms would have been having an eat all you can party." But Jesus still says, "Take away the stone." So after the stone was rolled away, Jesus gave thanks to God, because God was always hearing him. And he said this for the sake of the people who were gathered, that they would believe that Jesus was sent by God. And so Jesus cried out loudly, "Lazarus, come out!" Decomposition stopped, blood flowed once more, and Lazarus, bound in strips of cloth, came out of the tomb. Hopefully, Lazarus dead left, never sure yet. Because it is in our society, you might see some persons with the party who want justice. Worse if the man left in beds. I am fancy burn a coat, and I do get it. We are. What Jesus had done challenged all logical thinkers. He sent back to the drawing board all fortune tellers, all sorcerers, and he ridiculed some of the beliefs of the Jews. The awesomeness of God manifested in Jesus Christ was on display for all to see. Death was. And so many Jews who had witnessed Lazarus being restored to life came to believe in Jesus. As believers here today, it is our responsibility to share this hope with those around us. If we believe that death is not the end for believers, we need to share this with those around us. What we really need to do is to help persons to become believers in Jesus Christ. And how do we help them? We help them by encouraging them to move out of the house of doubts
and relocate to the house of Paul on Faith Avenue. Remember, love lives upstairs, and trust will be their new neighbor. Therefore, believers, using the resources available to us, let us help others to see that death is not the end, but is necessary. It is a necessary transition which we all must pass through if we want to spend eternity with God. So I encourage us, as we approach Holy Week, where we will recall all the events leading up to Good Friday and then Easter, let us take all our concerns to the foot of the cross and leave them there. And also let us continue to prepare ourselves to meet our Savior, so that when we, on our last mile of this earthly life, we'll be able to say, it is well with our souls, we can also await our own transition. And so encourage us, like Martha, to be able to say, Lord, I am here.
Page 104. Let us stand as we offer our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen or unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of God, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, one who lives with the Father, through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake, he was crucified on the mountain's island. He suffered and died and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In fulfillment of the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy, heavenly, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world. Page 270, the Litany of Penitence. Dear friends in Christ, here in the presence of Almighty God, let us reflect on His holy word, and with penitent and obedient hearts, confess our sins, so that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. Bless the Lord who forgives sins. Together we pray.
Most holy and merciful God, we give our best to you and to one another, and to the whole communion of saints, heaven and earth, that we may sing by our own heart, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not loved ourselves as we ought. We have not forgiven others as we desire to be forgiven. We have not forgiven ourselves as we have been forgiven. We have been deaf to your call to serve as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit.
Have mercy on us, Lord.
We confess to you, Lord, all our past unfaithfulness, the pride, hypocrisy, and impatience of our lives.
We confess to you, Lord,
our self-indulgent appetites and ways, our exploitation of other people. Our anger at our own frustration and our envy of those more fortunate than ourselves. Our intemperate love of worldly goods and comfort and our dishonesty in daily life and work. Our negligence in prayer and worship, and our failure to commend the faith that is in us. Accept our repentance, Lord, for the wrongs we have done, for our blindness to human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty. For all false judgments, for uncharitable thoughts towards our neighbors, and for our prejudice and contempt towards those who differ from us. For our waste and pollution of your creation, and our lack of concern for those who come after us. Restore us, good Lord, and let your anger depart from us. Accomplish in us the work of your salvation. By the cross and passion of your Son, O Lord,
bring us to all your sins,
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desires not the death of sinners, but rather that they may turn from your wickedness and live, has given us power and commandment to ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of your sins. He pardons and he absolves all those who are truly penitent, and with sincere hearts believe his holy gospel. Therefore, we beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which you do on this day, and the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Page 124. the greeting of peace. If you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Is it for the offering?
bread, this wine, this money. We thank thee of ourselves, our lives, and our work, to become through your Holy Spirit, a reason, holy and life sacrifice. As this bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ, so will we and all your people become channels of your love, to receive Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing. Always and ever to give you thanks, Father Almighty, everlasting God. For you bid your people, cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the paschal feast. That fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by the word and sacraments, they come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Our faith.
His glorious resurrection and ascension, his continual intercession for us in heaven, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you thanksgiving, this holy and life-giving sacrifice. Look with favor on your churches and prayers, and grant that we will eat and drink these holy gifts, may be filled with your Holy Spirit, and become one body in Christ, and serve in unity, constancy, and peace. May he make us a perpetual offering to you, and enable us in communion with Blessed Mary, Blessed Mark, and the whole company of heaven to share in the inheritance of your saints. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in the heaven, in songs of everlasting praise.
Thank you.
teaching. May the Lord give you His grace and presence to deliver us from the evil and the Holy Spirit. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord give you His grace and presence to deliver us from the Christ, our God, make yourself known to us.
Jesus Christ, Son of God, make yourself known to us. Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, speak to us, to others. Almighty Father,
we thank you for being us, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ.
May he who share his body live his life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We upon whom your Spirit shines, give light to the world. Help us to continue in faithful witness to your word, so we and all your children shall be free. My whole earth with the praise of you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. For your gifts of God's blessing. Christ give you grace to grow in holiness. To deny yourselves, take up your cross and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Let me extend a special welcome to you all. Special welcome to those who have joined us online. But it's very good also to have our children with us. And we continue to encourage our ministry of having our children by us going to pick them up on a Sunday morning. And special thanks to those who ensure that that ministry of ours. I must also extend a special welcome to Gabrielle, who is here with us worshiping. So we continue to encourage us all to be safe. Remember, we're still in a pandemic. Please may God bless you all. And please, just a quick notice, next week Sunday, being Palm Sunday, we will start at 7 p.m. At the gate as usual. So repeat, next week Sunday, being Palm Sunday, we will start at 7 p.m. at the gate, liturgy, for the blessing of the path, and then we process into the church. Our closing prayer. 436, following which we will recess in silence. Have a blessed rest of the week. God bless you all. Thank you.
be with you.
No.